My name is Ludmila Lambajnová. I was doctoral research fellow at Wirth Institute 3 years ago. And now I work at State Regional Archives in Litoměřice. And basically what I am doing now is to arranging a family collection of the House of Korčmisin-Kersenbrodsk into series. It's my job. And now I would like to present this topic to you, and I am very grateful to Wirth Institute for inviting me to this exciting project. So let's start with outline of presentation. I will say a brief introduction into nobility in Bohemia, or precisely in the Austro-Hungarian Empire at the turn of 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. Then I will say more details about archivist job. And thirdly, the main hero of our presentation is nobleman Clemens Kersenbrock and his life story in Bohemia. So this is a map of Kingdom of Bohemia within Austro-Hungarian at the beginning of the First World War. We can see that after First World War, this Kingdom of Bohemia became Czechoslovakia, and now it's Czechia or the Czech Republic. Maybe some of you know that for landscape of the Czech Republic is very typical splendid castles almost everywhere. So these splendid castles were built by Bohemian aristocracy. It's true that by the end of the 19th century, around 300 noble families owned roughly 36% of all Bohemian land. So we speak about very prestigious social group, very powerful social group. But I would like to say more about less known aristocratic family, about family of Korčmisin-Kersenbrock. Firstly, I would like to say more about archives. You can see the definition of archives, because as I have already mentioned, I work at State Regional Archive Litoměřice, and now I am trying to make accessible the family collection of noble family Korčmisin-Kersenbrock accessible for archival researcher. So I am creating a coherent collection. The reason for creating a coherent collection is the fact that very rarely collection which are coming to archive are neatly arranged. So I basically try to arrange documents, letters, personal paper, etc. into series. And this is how it looked like at the beginning. This is a family letter of family Korčmisin-Kersenbrock, and this is original package from the beginning of 20th century. And this is how it came to the archives. Actually, this is a very good question, how it came that we now have this family collection in our archives. You can see the picture of a married couple. It's older married couple. This is photo from 50s of 20th century. On your left is Leopoldine Korschwitzenkersenbrock, born of Lobkowitz. So she was born a noblewoman. She came from a very prestigious old Czech noble family of Lobkowitz. And this is her husband, Rember Kersenbrock. And actually, this married couple decided in 70s gave their family collection to the archive. So let's start from the beginning. You can see a family tree of House of Kersenbrock. House of Kersenbrock is very old German noble family. The first mention is from 13th century. And this family is connected with Westphalia in Germany. But now we are basically interested only in this nobleman, Clemens August. He was born in 1839 and he died before the First World War. You can see that the nobility as social group was very international, as his stepmother Anna Jordan came from United Kingdom, and thanks to this Clemens August, as we can see later, was able to write and speak in English. Basically, we are interested only in Clemens August, as he was first member of the House of Kersenbrock who came to Bohemia, which was the part of the Austro-Hungary that time. So this is the photo of Clemens August Korschmissen-Kersenbrock. So he was a soldier. He entered the Prussian army, as we know that he came originally from Germany. But he was forced to leave the Prussian army and he decided to enter the Austrian army. Then he fought in the war of 1866, which was Austro-Prussian war. So this is a great paradox of his life, that he basically fought against his former co-soldier. So after he was retired from the Austrian army, he decided to settle in Bohemia. He decided to rent a castle Liechtenstein, not to be mistaken with the state of Liechtenstein, please. As I have already mentioned, what was typical for the nobility that time was bilingualism. This was typical, especially for Bohemian nobility. So he rented a castle called in German Liechtenstein, and in Czech is Líšťany. He decided to marry. He married a noble woman from very old Czech noble family. Her name was Terezia Ležanská of Buková. He possibly could meet her, as castle of her family was situated not far from the castle Liechtenstein. So he married her. The son Clemens August was born from this marriage, and unfortunately after 2 years of marriage she died during a hunting accident. She was shot, and so Clemens Kersenbrock became a widower with a little son. Then we don't know how, but he met Maria Gabriela of Lobkowitz from very old, very prestigious Czech aristocracy family. As I read his letter to Marie Gabrielle of Lobkowitz, I can certainly tell that he fell in love with her. We have lots of letters which he wrote to her as she became his fiance, and then she became his wife. So I have already mentioned the castle Liechtenstein. So the married couple settled in Liechtenstein. It's basically near Pilsen. It's somewhere here. So this is Marie Gabriele Lobkowicz. This is young Marie Gabriele Lobkowicz. I know that she kept diaries in French, so she knew several languages. This was typical for the Bohemian aristocracy. She knew German, French, and also Czech. Actually, we don't have any wedding photos from their wedding. We know that they had wedding in San Henry Church in Prague, but we have a wedding mini card. It's written in French. As you can see, this is also typical for Bohemian aristocracy, and you can see that they had grilled roe deer for the main dish. So I have already mentioned that Marie Gabrielle and Clemens had very lovely relationship. So when Clemens Kersenbrock traveled, every time he sent a postcard or a letter to his wife. So you can see a postcard addressed to his wife. He actually traveled a lot, especially to Germany, but also to different regions of Bohemia, as his favorite activity was hunting, which was typical leisure activities for nobility that time. I have already mentioned that he knew several languages, so in his correspondence we can found letters written mainly in German, but also in English. So you can read a letter to his wife full of emotion of love. I have already mentioned that Clemens August had already children from the first marriage, but they had also their own children. So from the second marriage, Rembert was born, then Therese, Denka, and George. You can see from this life diet that Zdenka died being 12 years old, and poor little George died being 5 years old. Actually, Rembrandt went to boarding school to Feldkirchen. He went to this boarding school with his stepbrother Clemens, and then he went to university and he studied law, and then he became a judge. He was the man who gave this family collection to the archive. Therese is very interesting, and I will say more about her later. I have already mentioned the family correspondence. Actually, not only Clemens traveled, also Marie Gabrielle traveled. She came every year to Spa. This was also typical for noble women. So this is a letter which was sent by Clemens to his wife. And obviously, Father Clemens went with children to the forest. they collective leaves and dried flowers, stick on postcard, and they send it to mom. And we can see the name of children, Rembert, Zdenka, Teres, and Father Clemens here. Let's say several words about education of children. What was typical for education within noble families was stress on language education. We can read in this family collection letters written by children to parents in different languages. Here we you can read the letter in Czech. The letter was signed by all children, Rembert, Teres, Denka, and Jiřík, which is Czech version of George. This letter is very sweet as it contains several grammar errors. So I have already mentioned the very sad story of little George. Here you can see a picture of Marie Gabrielle, the mother, and little George. Actually, the death of little George was very serious blow for both parents, but I can say that this was very serious blow, especially for Marie Gabrielle, the mother, as she later claimed that she wasn't never same after the death of the little George. What we know that this death of little George gained lots of sympathy from different people. The proof are letters of sympathy which were sent from different social groups, from peasants, from local peoples, from nuns. And here you can read a letter in English addressed to Clemens Korschmitzenkern Sembrock. The letter was written by Francis Norris, which was obviously based in Russia, in St. Petersburg. You can see here the address. And here, I don't know who was Francis Norris, so if somebody knows, I would be really grateful for the information. But it's another proof that the Czech nobility was very international. I have mentioned the education, so the both sons of Kersenbrock went to boarding school in Feldkirchen. This was really prestigious boarding school run by Jesuit priests. And Father Clemens decided to make a trip with son Clemens. So they went together to Switzerland, to Einsiedeln. They sent a postcard to mom, and the son Clemens returned to Feldkirchen. It's all written here in old German alphabet called Kurenschrift. And here you can see second times Clemens, which basically means Clemens' son and father. So regarding Teres Korschmitzenkern Sembrock, it's very interesting person. We don't know much about her education, but certainly she had to be very well educated. She knew several languages, certainly English, French, German, and Czech. She never married. She was single, and thanks to the fact fact that she stayed single, she could become a governess in the royal family. What we know from the family correspondence, there was a nobleman, Friedrich Merwald, who was interesting in marrying Therese Korfmissing Kersenbrod, but they didn't end up married after all. We don't know why. It's possible that Therese Korfmissing wasn't interesting. Actually, Friedrich Merwald, a German nobleman, married another woman, and he died during First World War as he was soldier. During First World War, Therese Korfmissing-Kersenbrod became a governess in the family of Karl I, the last emperor of Austro-Hungary. This is Emperor Karl I, his wife Zita, and their children. Actually, Therese Korfmissing-Kersenbrod became governess of all their children. And even after collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, she followed the royal family to the exile. This is very interesting train card. There is line called Dienstagentschaft, which could be translated as occupation, and occupation is the governess of the imperial family. And this is train card of Therese, Countess Korfmissing-Kersenbrod. It's written here. Actually, she became governess in 1918, which was the last year of Austro-Hungarian monarchy. Actually, as I have already mentioned, she stayed with imperial family even after the end of the First World War. And it seems to me that the imperial children loved her, as they sent lots of letters to her. They called her Liebe Korfi, Dear Korfi. And as they were younger, they draw pictures for her. This is, for example, birthday wish. It's a birthday march composed by Otto Habsburg. He was 6 years old at that time. And this was special birthday march composed for Therese Korfmissing-Kersenbrod, for his governess. And this is other picture for Therese Korfmissing-Kersenbrod, made by Adelheid for Habsburg. She was 7 years old that time. So I would like to make several conclusions. So I would like to remind you the international character of Bohemian nobility. We can see that they had contacts all over the Europe. They knew several languages. This was because the noble families put stress on foreign language education. We can see that firstly was homeschooling, then boarding school for boys. And this excellent language education enabled, for example, Therese Korfmissing-Kersenbrod made very international career. And I think I have already proved loving relationship within the family of Korfmissing-Kersenbrod. So I would like to conclude it with the list of sources. So there are several links about archives and archivists, which I would like to recommend you. I use several primary sources, which are preserved in State Regional Archives Litoměřice. if somebody would be interesting in German part of House of Korschmissing and some broad, it should he or she should go to Archiv am für Westfalen in Germany. And I would like to thank to Adrian Korschmissing-Kersmer for giving me very interesting details about her family. Thank you for your attention, and please don't hesitate me to contact me for further information about the topic. Thank you and goodbye.